The opinions expressed by the host and guests on Where Did the Road Go are their own and do not represent those of WVBR or its management. Our aim is to explore the fringe, lost civilizations, alternative science, the paranormal, and much more. Join us on the web at wheredidtheroadgo.com, where you can send us questions for our live or future guests via email or the live chat room. And remember to subscribe to us on iTunes. And now welcome to this week's edition of Where Did the Road Go?
And I am your host, Soraya, and this week on Where Did the Road Go, we're going to be talking to Nick Redfern. And Nick is a very prolific writer. You may have also seen him on Ancient Aliens, Monster Quest, UFO Hunters. He's been really all over the place. And if you have any questions for Nick while we're talking, you can come into our chat room at www.wheredidtheroadgo.com. And, you know, I'll pass them along. Are you with us, Nick?
Excuse me. Yes, I am, Soraya. How's it going?
Hi. All right. So we were talking before this. How many books do you actually have out?
I think it's either 26, 27, 28, something like that. But I've always got a couple of books as well that I'm sort of writing. When one's come out, another one's already sort of being written, or maybe two. So it's kind of a bit of a vague area, I guess, right?
Because you legitimately seem to put out a book every 6 months or so.
Well, I do. I mean, providing, you know, there's a sort of couple of provisos. One, that I can bring something new to the table each time and, you know, not go over old ground and, you know, be able to present something where, you know, I feel it's going to add to our knowledge and further the mystery that we're, you know, the relevant mystery that the book's looking at. So those are the main things. It's not a case of writing it just to get another book out. You know, I want to be able to add something where you feel you're giving the audience, you know, something for their $15 or whatever. You know, you don't want to cheat them and just, you know, put out whatever, you know. So, but I mean, I do this full time, so writing sort of in the day, 9 to 5, Monday to Friday. I like to keep regular sort of hours. I mean, some writers, you know, they sort of get inspired and work through the night. I like to sort of keep it regular, and then I sort of switch off at 5, have a normal life at night, normal life at weekends, and then 9 to 5, as I said, in the week, write the book. So, you know, when you're doing it 9 to 5 every day, or Monday to Friday, you know, and 48, 49 weeks a year, aside from vacations, then you can get a lot done and soon sort of, you know, knock a book out, so to speak.
All right. And you know, you always put out quality stuff, even if it's a new twist on something people might not already know about. I mean, like your new book, Monster Files, you're covering cryptozoology, but you're doing it in investigating what the government might actually know about these things and what the government's involvement and stuff is. And that's, I don't think anyone's ever done that before.
Well, no, I mean, again, this is the sort of thing I look for. I mean, you know, there's a lot of books out there on Bigfoot or the Loch Ness Monster or the Chupacabra, whatever. But you're right, nobody's sort of really dug into what agencies, official agencies around the world know or knew about these particular topics. And so that's why I felt it was legitimate, you know, to do this. If I'd just written a book where it was one chapter on the history of Bigfoot and one on the history of Nessie and one on the history of the Yeti, you know, that would just be basically ripping off a bunch of stuff that was already out there and condensing it down, you know, and there's no point doing that, because what's the point of just not doing anything original? So that's sort of the thing I always look for, is even if the subject matter's been dealt with before, like Bigfoot, you know, brings something new to it, like, well, what does the military know about it? You know, what does the government know about it? And so that's basically what the theme of the new book.
Okay. And you actually use, you're not just wildly speculating in this book. You're digging up, like, Freedom of Information Act files and stuff like that. What gave you the idea to even do this?
Well, I guess when you write books, you know, whenever I have a book that comes out, you know, within the sort of the first 3-4 weeks after they come out, you just get a mass of emails from people who say, you know, hey, I wanted to share my story because I read the book and it reminded me of ABC, you know, so people tell you their stories. And over the years, I got a lot of snippets of stories about official interest in strange creatures. You know, somebody would say, well, you know, I reported this sighting, and then somebody came out, you know, like a Mothman sighting, and then this sort of man in black type character came out to interview me, and then there were other people who said, you know, they worked analyzing alleged photographs of Bigfoot or like things like that for the military. And so over the time, I got a lot of snippets and fragments of stories, and I thought, well, you know, if I actually sat down and put all these together and researched them and followed all these trails and leads, then there's a potential book there. So that's what I did. I spent like a year or so, you know, when I had spare moments here and there, to research all these different stories and follow them up with witness interviews or with Freedom of Information Act requests. And then, you know, finally the point came where it was like, well, there is enough material now. So that's sort of what started it, was, you know, when people contact me with leads and information, you know.
Okay. Well, let's go over some of the stuff you have in here. This is it's pretty much packed full of information here, and you cover everything from, you know, Bigfoot to Loch Ness to Chupacabra to actually my favorite in here is the Flatwoods Monster, I think.
Oh, yeah, that's a weird one, yeah.
Because I know the story, and it's always been touted as a high-strangeness UFO case, but you have a potential other twist on it.
Yeah, the Flatwoods has certainly become one of the classic cases of ufology, and, you know, some people give it sort of a cryptozoological crossover because it's become known as the Flatwoods Monster, you know, sort of like a monstrous creature. But it goes back to September 52, when in Flatwoods, West Virginia, this little town, it's still only a small town today of about 300 people, and something strange was seen streaking across the sky, and it seemed to come down in an area of woodland behind a large hill. And so a number of the local people who'd seen all the sort of fuss and commotion in the skies went up to the hill and through the woods to figure out what was going on, and they were confronted by what they described as like a 12-foot tall humanoid type figure, which had all these weird electric sparks and flashes coming from it, and these glowing eyes, and you know, it just looked like some sort of demonic type 12-foot tall sort of cross between some monstrous humanoid and almost like a robot type figure. And so, not surprisingly, everybody fled down the hill, and the creature was reportedly never seen again. You know, it was like one of these sort of curious standalone cases. You know, it's like with UFOs, there are countless reports of flying saucers or alien abductions, but the Flatwood Monster was kind of like a one-off, you know, and it kind of came and then went. And you're right, it has become sort of like a staple classic part of ufological history and lore. And I was doing some research into one particular aspect of the book that I cover on a number of occasions about how monster legends had been sort of exploited as like a military psychological warfare purposes. And I got hold of a RAND document which talked about how, or the history of how sort of superstitions and folklore could be used to exploit and frighten the enemy, particularly in superstitious countries, you know, where folklore and myths were held sort of very seriously. And I was sort of amazed to find in there, bear in mind this is a document prepared by RAND for the Air Force in 1950, and Flatwoods is only 2 years later. And it makes mention in there of how in the Second World War, the British Army had tried to essentially frighten the villagers in certain parts of Italy where they were helping the Germans. And they created this 12-foot tall monster that sounds eerily like the Flatwoods Monster. And bear in mind, this is coming from official Freedom of Information files. They talk about how the British Army constructed this thing 12 feet high, just like the Flatwoods Monster. And they attached all these sort of powerful batteries to it that created all these sparks and flashes and almost like mini lightning sparks coming from it, which is very much like what people described at Flatwoods. And what they did, they sort of unleashed it on the villages, on the fringes of the villages in the nearby woods, to where, you know, the guys who were sort of controlling it wouldn't be seen. They'd always use it late at night, and they would just sort of, you know, sort of push it forward, and they'd sort of hide just sort of 2 or 3 feet behind it in the darkness. And of course, people couldn't see behind it because their eyes were blinded, you know, by all the flashing lights. But it served its purpose. Now, this was 45 when the operation, 44 when the operation occurred. Rand wrote it up in 50 for the Air Force, and then only 2 years later, you have the Flatwoods case, which the military actually took a deep interest in determining what the public response was. You know, they were very interested in, you know, what people were saying about it. So that does make me wonder if it was like some sort of psychological test, and then they sat back and saw what the reaction was. You know, and people said, well, why would they do that? Well, you know, I mean, if you can determine how easy it is to spread rumors and folklore and tales that actually aren't true, you know, you can gauge how well they might work on an enemy, particularly, as I said, in like a superstitious part of the world where folklore and myths and stories of monsters could be easily exploited and used, you know, against the enemy rather than just using bombs or bullets or whatever.
And it seemed to me that the UFO phenomena has always been used by the government to test things like that, to test how easily rumors or legends will spread, and they just kind of monitor it.
Yeah, and I think it's important to note, I mean, my personal view is that when it comes to cryptozoology and ufology, although we see evidence of agencies around the world, you know, sort of using these stories as covers for something else, for me, it doesn't take away from the fact that there are genuine unknown phenomena as well. You know, I don't think it's all fabricated stuff to for whatever obscure reason. I think it's like with UFOs, I think there's a genuine unknown phenomenon, but that doesn't take away the fact that military agencies all around the world might be flying weird-looking things that get mistaken for a UFO, you know, but it doesn't mean there aren't real UFOs, you know. I'm 100% certain there are. It's kind of the same with these monster legends. Just because the Flatwoods monster may, and I stress may, have been some sort of weird military creation, it doesn't take away the fact that people see something like Bigfoot, you know.
Right, right. And, I mean, there are obviously test flights of secret craft that they've used UFOs to cover. And I often wonder if the whole Project Mogul, where they came out as the explanation from Roswell, if that was, you know, they may have been telling the truth and also analyzing it to see that, you know, how many people are going to believe the truth if that was the truth, you know?
Yeah, I mean, Roswell's kind of like a weird case because, it's, you know, it's so long ago and, you know, we've got no files and, you know, it's not like the government's saying we're not going to talk about it. You know, they say, well, this is what it was. It was a Mogul balloon, and any talk of bodies, they were just crash test dummies. I mean, a lot of people have sort of painted the Air Force as the bad guys in all this, and ironically, I don't. You know, I actually do wonder. I have kind of an alternative theory on the whole Mogul balloon theory and the crash test dummy theory. You know, a lot of people said, oh, this is just the government covering it up or the Air Force covering it up. I actually think there's a very strong probability, and to the point where I do believe this, the Air Force went looking and couldn't find anything at all on Roswell. but felt, you know, because they were looking, you know, the responsible thing to do was to try and come up with an explanation. And I think they honestly tried to come up with the best explanation they could, even bearing in mind that they had no evidence or no documents that they could find to actually confirm it officially. So my view is that whatever happened at Roswell, I think the files vanished years ago, probably into some sort of black budget type program that's buried so deeply that today's military doesn't even know what happened. Then, you know, ironically, there could be people in the Pentagon sitting around saying, I wonder what happened at Roswell, you know, like us, because the real secret is buried so deeply by, you know, a group that, like I said, one of these black budget programs. So I actually don't, I think the Air Force were in an unfortunate position. I don't paint them as the bad guys at all. I think they were, you know, they were put on the spot. They looked for the material. They couldn't find it. And I can imagine a situation where they probably said, well, if we say nothing, then it's just going to increase the conspiracy theories. So we've got to say something. So I think they tried to come up with an explanation that seemed feasible based on the historical records of various balloon operations that were going on at that time. But of course, you know, it sort of fell short in the minds of the UFO research community, and they perceived it as being more of the cover-up or the conspiracy. I view it as, you know, the fact that they went looking and found nothing, but it was, as I said, the responsible thing to try and find something, you know.
I always thought John Keel's explanation was a pretty good one. The was it the Fugo balloon, was it called?
The Japanese balloon bombs. Yeah. I mean, the thing is, there's interesting data, which what my
You there, Nick? I don't know what happened. He just kind of disappeared into the ether. Okay. I'm going to try calling him back because, we just lost him. All right, let's try again. See what happened there. You are listening to Where Did the Road Go? We're talking to Nick Redfern, and we're calling him back now to see if we can get him back on the line because he just kind of, that was a really weird sound. Just kind of went away. Hey, let's see. And we're going to be doing, I've now confirmed this, we're going to be doing some midweek podcasts here and there that are going to not be, you know, aired here on WVBR. They'll just be midweek, not necessarily every week. There's not going to be a set schedule for it or anything. And what we're going to do is once a month, we're probably going to have Micah Hanks on. Once a month, we're going to have Paul Kimball. And the other weeks, we're going to have other authors and stuff doing maybe short bits or controversial authors that I can't necessarily put on the show because their content is a little too touchy, I guess you could say. Nick's not answering. All right, let's try again. So we're going to start doing that hopefully in the next few weeks. And I'm going to have, for instance, Andrew Collins will be coming on again. Just to talk about the news that Göbekli Tepe is aligned to Sirius, he disagrees, and he's going to present his case. Ah, there we go. Hey there, hello. Nick. You just kind of hello. You just kind of disappeared into the ether on us.
Yeah, I guess the man in black intercepted us or something. I don't know. He just suddenly went dead here, so I wasn't exactly sure what had happened. But,
yeah, it made a really weird noise.
Oh. Oh, that's strange.
Like you started talking about the balloons and it just kind of went and disappeared.
Yeah, well that's weird. But yeah, what I was saying is that you know with it being such an old case and pretty much everybody's gone now, there's no documents. It's kind of like I'm sort of liken it to like an American version of Jack the Ripper, where it's a fascinating old mystery. There are all sorts of different theories, but everybody's gone and you almost reach this brick wall and. Unfortunately, you know, it doesn't help our position, but, you know, people ask me honestly, I just don't see how we can solve the case. Mm. Because, you know, what do you do when the witnesses are all dead and there are no files anywhere and, you know, every agency of government has said, you know, that nobody's saying we found files and you cannot see them. They're all saying we've gone looking and there's nothing.
Right.
You know, there's nothing in the official archives anywhere. So it's like, what do you do? You know, that's the problem. I just don't see what the next step is. You know, it could be the make or break case that proves, you know, the legitimacy of the subject. But it's like, how do you get further? I just don't know.
Well, another example in your book of them using this kind of monster operation was the vampires.
Yeah, that's a strange story as well, yeah.
And want to tell people a little about that?
Yeah, sure. Well, this relates to an operation in the Philippines in the early 50s when the Philippine government was facing an uprising for what were known as the Huk rebels, H-U-K, that were trying to overthrow the regular government. And the Philippine government approached the U.S. and said, you know, can you give us some military aid? And they said, sure. And one of the people who came on board was a Major General Edward Lansdale. And Lansdale was an expert in the field of psychological warfare, which is basically sort of using skills and to defeat the enemy without sort of bullets, bombs, rifles, whatever. And it's essentially a lot of it came down to things like exploiting myths and folklore and then using them, targeting the enemy with them. And so what Lansdale did was to look into the history and beliefs of the Huk rebels, and it turned out that they were actually very superstitious of the idea that, or the belief, that there were sort of strange, monstrous creatures living in the forests of the Philippines. And the one that they were most frightened of was a creature known as the Aswang vampire, A-S-W-A-N-G. And it wasn't sort of like a cloaked vampire of, you know, the Bela Lugosi or anything like that. And he wasn't sort of like the true blood type of today. It was more, but it was like a humanoid type creature that would sort of prey on people and drink their blood. So Lansdale came up with this ingenious ploy to try and defeat the Hucks. And what he did, they had this sort of little device created, and Lansdale actually spoke about this in his before his death in his autobiography, which was published back in the 1990s. And he sort of told the whole story of the operation, where they created this little device, which essentially was created to sort of mimic the appearance and of like a classic vampire bite. So, in other words, what they did, Lansdale got sort of a crack team of personnel together, like a Delta Force team kind of thing, and stealthily went out in the forest late one night to find the nearest Huck camp. And they pounced on one of the nearest guards they could find and pulled him to the ground and basically killed him by inserting, you know, sort of stabbing him in the jugular vein with this two-pronged device, which, as I said, sort of mimicked the appearance of a vampire bite. Then they strung him up by the ankles over a tree and let the blood drain out of the body. And then before dawn broke the next day, they carefully and quietly took the body back as close as they could to the Huck rebel camp. And, of course, then when, you know, they started looking around for the comrade, where was he? And they found him, you know, sort of looking pale and white, dead, and with his puncture wounds. They fled the area. You know, they got all their equipment together and just left because they felt, you know, they believed there was an Aswang vampire on the loose. And Lansdale's guys would keep doing this. They'd push further and further, and the Hucks would keep retreating further and further, thinking the vampires were closing in on them. So it was a fascinating situation where you had a monster legend which was brought to life in a strange way, and key strategic ground was retrieved for the Philippine government with barely a shot being fired. It was all just done, you know, creating fear out of a non-existent monster.
Wow. The one of the subjects we've talked to a few people here on the show is sort of the supernatural elements involving Bigfoot. And you delve into that a little bit in this book too, the connection between Bigfoot and UFOs and such. And you know, it seems to me like I've talked to people who believe in the physical reality that they're just big apes running around, and I've talked to people that believe there's something else, that there's some kind of manifestation. Where do you fall on this subject?
Oh, well, I definitely fall into the second category. I mean, you know, the subject of cryptozoology, for all intents and purposes, is the study of unknown animals. But the problem is that the more we look into these things, some of them seem either sort of more or paradoxically less than real flesh and blood animals. Now, you know, people talk about Bigfoot, and most cryptozoologists will say, well, it's just an unknown type of, you know, it's a North American equivalent of like an African gorilla, but science and zoology just haven't happened to have classified and caught one yet. And, you know, at the end of the day, it may well come down to that. We just don't know. But the problem is that there's a significant number of reports that kind of push Bigfoot out of the just a straightforward realm of being a flesh and blood animal. For example, the reports where people have seen it sort of fade away into a mist, or like vanish in a flash of light, or strange lights and UFOs have been seen hovering over the woods in the same time period and location as Bigfoot. And there are examples where footprints seem to have vanished, and people have actually, they've been in the vicinity of Bigfoot, and they felt like it's almost like disabled them by sort of zapping them with some sort of like a psychic weapon, where they've gone dizzy and disoriented, and it's allowed the creature to escape. So when you put all those aspects together, I think that there's something far stranger than to Bigfoot than just being an unknown ape. You know, the Bigfoot is one of the few animals, along with all these other so-called cryptids, as they're known, that manage to elude us 100% of the time. You know, it's like most people never ever see in the wild a mountain lion or a bear. But people do see them, and we catch them, and we put them in zoos, or they get shot. But Bigfoot doesn't elude us 90 or 95% of the time. Bigfoot eludes us 100% of the time on 100% of every occasion. And when that happens, you've got to, for me at least, that sort of smacks of there's got to be something strange going on. No animal can be that lucky 100% of the time, you know. And I think there's something to the idea, as some people think, that Bigfoot could sort of potentially be some sort of dimensional creature, you know, that sort of flits in and out of our reality. And it may actually be highly evolved. You know, we think because it's hairy and lumbering around the woods, it's stupid and primitive. It might not be. It might be a highly evolved creature that but actually, you know, that doesn't necessarily use technology as we do, but uses a very different technology, you know, like, as I said, like a dimension hopping one almost.
Yeah. Well, and I would say there's also the possibility there could be a small nuts and bolts, let's say, a small physical group of these type of animals somewhere in the world, and that the phenomena is copying it, too.
Well, yeah, I mean, for example, I don't sort of class all cryptids or even all mystery apes into that category. I think Bigfoot, there's no doubt, for me at least, there's something weirder going on. And we get a lot of reports in Britain, and most of those reports are of large ape-like creatures, but nearly all of them have, like, a paranormal aspect. Hmm. But in saying that, for example, in Sumatra, you have this creature that's become known as the orang pendek, and which is like a smaller sort of 3 to 4 foot tall, almost like a primitive humanoid ape-like creature. And I don't think there's anything paranormal about that at all. I actually wouldn't be at all surprised if we don't, in the very near future, get firm evidence of orang pendek. And I think it'll be shown to be either an unknown type of ape, but a highly intelligent one, or possibly a very, very, very primitive form of a human, or an offshoot of the human race, that we simply don't know about. You know, we know of Neanderthal man and Cro-Magnon man. This may have been, you know, something far stranger, because it's almost like a pygmy type creature, like 3 to 4 feet tall, but it's been reported carrying spears and things like that. So you know, but I don't think there's anything, you know, remotely supernatural or dimension jumping about that. So I think, you know, with cryptozoology, there are various aspects. There's the paranormal angle, there's the genuine flesh and blood creatures, which we haven't found yet. There could be some creatures which are, you know, believed to become extinct and that haven't. And then there are other animals which are, which is a sort of a sub-aspect of cryptozoology. They're known as out-of-place animals. Mm. Like, for example, in Britain, we get a lot of reports of big cats on the loose, but, you know, there shouldn't be any big cats in Britain. So here, there's a mystery, but the mystery is not what the creature is. It's why it's being seen in a country or an area where it shouldn't exist. So, you know, so you've got all these different aspects to cryptozoology.
Right. And the and you trace a couple of these Bigfoot stories where the government supposedly captured them or shot one, or but nothing that you could really pin down, was there?
No, I mean, this is the thing I pointed out in the book. You know, a lot of the book is based on official declassified Freedom of Information files, but there are a number of stories in there where it just comes from the witnesses. Now, there's nothing, I say just from the witnesses, you know, that's not to put them down. I mean, without the witnesses, we have nothing when it comes to this subject. You know, we're reliant on people sharing their stories. But the Bigfoot autopsies and, you know, bodies on ice and that kind of thing, you know, I'll be the first to admit that we've got some very interesting testimony, and some from retired military personnel. What we don't have is any official documents to back this up, at least not yet. The most famous story of all of them is, I mean, altogether there's probably 10 or 15 different stories and different strands, but the most famous one, or series of them, relates to the Mount St. Helens explosion in May 1980, when Mount St. Helens in Washington State, there was this huge volcanic eruption where the mountain had been sort of rumbling for weeks previously, and it was clear that there was going to be an eruption, and it finally happened in May 1980, and it was a gigantic blast that sent plumes of smoke and literally tons and tons of ash and dirt into the sky, and the blast actually traveled horizontally from the mountain at 150 miles an hour. That's how fast it was, and there were dozens of people who didn't heed the warning and stayed in the homes, were just basically vaporized and, you know, killed outright. And there were a lot of animals were killed. There was more than 1,000 elk and various other animals. And a number of military and regular emergency services went in to obviously help the people and try and put out the wildfires and things like that, and also help, you know, the animals that were injured and et cetera. And since then, that's happened. The first story actually surfaced literally only weeks after, and since then and up until now, as I said, we've got about 10 or 15 retired military people who have come forward talking about either their involvement or their knowledge from friends and colleagues about so-called Bigfoot-type bodies being found on the mountain and being sort of airlifted out in nets by large double-rotor military helicopters and taken for autopsy to military bases. Now, if we just had one or two of these stories and they were all identical, you know, you might think, well, it's a bit suspicious, but what we actually have are various people talking about different angles. You know, somebody was on the helicopter, somebody else was on the ground, somebody was responsible for taking pictures and, you know, recording all the evidence, which kind of makes it sound more believable. The other problem is, you know, most of these people haven't gone on the record. You know, they don't feel comfortable doing that, which is fair enough, but you know, it does add to the sort of the frustration about trying to take the story further. But again, you know, for me, if the stories are true, then this is one of the reasons why I think Bigfoot is more paranormal. Because if it was just proven to be a giant ape, you know, a North American ape that science and zoology hadn't found, why should there be a cover-up? Why should the information be hidden, you know? There's no reason. You know, it's kind of like if we discovered a new kind of elephant in Africa, well, that's not going to be subject to a cover-up. You know, that would just be bizarre to think it would be. So why hide the existence of an ape previously unknown in the U.S. unless it's not just an ape? You know, and that's one of the reasons I come back to that. I think there's more to it, that, you know, I think it baffles the government, and maybe they know it's connected to other things, and that's why they're researching it, possibly.
All right, and the big cats you mentioned, I mean, they don't acknowledge those either, despite the enormous amount of sightings and stuff. And do you think these are physical flesh and blood animals?
Well, I mean, again, this is sort of like a grey area. I mean, in Britain, particularly where I'm originally from, every year you get hundreds of reports of people talking about seeing large black cats, totally black, but sort of the size of a typical American mountain lion, you know, so pretty big, muscular, ferocious animal. There shouldn't be anything like that in the UK at all, running wild. The largest, aside from house cats, you know, pet cats, the only other cat that lives in the UK and that does live in the wild is called the Scottish wildcat, but it's actually just about the same size as like a normal house cat. They actually are quite vicious, though. If you get close to them, you know, they won't waste any time sort of scratching you or biting you. They are literally wild, but there's nothing, you know, you wouldn't mistake them for anything else because they're just the size of a normal cat. Now, as far as these alien big cats, as they're known, or ABCs for short, sightings chiefly in terms of large numbers have been going on since the 60s, but you can actually find reports going back hundreds of years, which makes it more problematic as to where they came from, because in today's cases, in the UK, up until 1976, anyone could own a large cat, and after 1976, you had to have a license, and you had to build a big enclosure, and you had to be shown that, you know, the animal couldn't escape. You had to have a license, and it all cost a lot of money. Some people couldn't afford it, so the story is that they released their pets into the woods late at night, and, you know, because they didn't want them to go end up in a zoo or whatever, or be put down, and then they started breeding. You know, if they let loose males and females, and today we're seeing like the third or fourth generation after the 1976 releases, and I think that does explain some cases, but it doesn't explain the vast number that are sort of predate it. And there are, like with Bigfoot, there are some reports where people have talked about seeing these cats, and there are paranormal overtones to some of the stories. Now, I think the main reason why, particularly in Britain, the British government doesn't want to officially say, even though they've got a lot of reports on file, I think the reason they won't officially say, well, yes, they are out there, is because particularly the tabloid media, you know, they would whip up a frenzy of, you know, killer beasts on the loose, your children aren't safe, that kind of thing.
Right.
And I think from the government's perspective, it's the hysteria angle that they're trying to avoid. I think privately, you know, a lot of people in government who've studied this probably do believe they're out there, but, you know, it's weighing up, well, do we tell people or do we say there's nothing to it? Because, not because they're maliciously hiding, they just don't want to provoke, you know, sort of a bunch of people running around the woods with, you know, torches on, like in some old Frankenstein film, you know, and they just want to try and play it down for right. the public safety angle, I think, more than anything else.
And that's reasonable. Yeah. Now, wasn't there a government that flip-flopped on this? Was it Australia?
Well, yeah, I mean, the Australian government, they looked into this as well a few years ago, because just like in the UK, they get like, reports of large black cats, and again, there shouldn't be anything like that in Australia. And they prepared an official report, which is interesting, because it basically says that they consider it unlikely that these big cats are out there. However, they don't rule it out and are quite open to the idea of, you know, launching another investigation if further evidence sort of warranted it. So, you know, they've left the door open, so to speak, which is refreshing. You know, whereas the British government says their official story, this is almost word for word, is that unless further information comes in, you know, these things are just myths, and that's it, you know. So, but the Australians have been a little bit more lenient in saying, well, you know, we don't think this is going on, but we're not certainly not ruling it out, because that's what the witnesses are saying. It's just that we haven't found the evidence.
All right. Well, we got to take a quick break for about a minute. We'll be back in a moment with Nick Redfern.
In 2013, mysteries of the past will reshape our future. Paradigm Symposium 2013 in Minneapolis, Minnesota, October 17th through the 20th. Speakers will include Scott Wolter of History Channel's America Unearthed, Egyptologist Robert Bavall, Dr. Robert Schock, and many more. Tickets are available online at ParadigmSymposium.com. Mankind's greatest mysteries brought to the present with new understanding. Visit ParadigmSymposium.com.
The opinions expressed by the host and guests on Where Did the Road Go are their own and do not represent those of WVBR or its management. Join us on the web at WhereDidTheRoadGo.com, where you can send us questions for our live guests via email or the live chat room. You can also check out our upcoming schedule, blog, link section, book reviews, videos, and links to our Twitter, Facebook, iTunes, and much more. That's WhereDidTheRoadGo.com.
And tonight, we've been talking with Nick Redfern about his new book, Monster Files. You there, Nick?
Yes, I am, yeah.
All right. And another one of the cases I really found fascinating is the Mothman-like one that you talk about that happened in 1986.
Oh, yeah, the Danny Houston, you mean?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, again, this is sort of a one that I think people probably wouldn't have been aware of before, you know, like with Mothman. Mothman's probably the most famous winged thing, as they've become known. So these strange-looking humanoid, sort of quasi-humanoid forms with large wings with glowing red eyes. And you can find stories of creatures like this, not just throughout the world today, but throughout history, going back thousands of years. You know, all sorts of cultures had stories of humanoid creatures that were paranormal and had usually bat-like wings rather than, you know, feathery wings. And sometimes some people viewed them as like an omen to death, and others viewed them as like a warning entity that would surface when disasters were about to strike, but that they weren't the cause of them. And there's a famous one in Britain as well, known as the Owlman. And again, it's like a large humanoid thing with wings and glowing eyes, very, very similar to Mothman. And I investigated a series of reports, excuse me, that occurred around the NASA installation in Houston, Texas in 1986. And reportedly a number of members of the facility actually saw this creature late at night sort of hovering over the base high in the sky, you know, when it was like a bright full moon. You know, they could sort of see it silhouetted in the skies. And there were reportedly a number of strange animal mutilations in the area of dogs, where dogs were found killed and, you know, just sort of torn apart. But these sightings, these events, excuse me, occurred at the same time as the sightings. And so they made a tie-in there. But, you know, the story was kind of ended in a way you'd probably expect it to end, that, you know, the authorities were baffled by it and really couldn't do much other than just sort of log the information and say, well, you know, yes, something weird happened, but we don't know what. And, you know, it all kind of ended as weirdly as it began. But, I mean, there was something, I think there was something like 12 or 13 reports filed over the course of several months. And then, as I said, it culminated in these weird animal deaths, and then it just came to an end. But, you know, it was intriguing that it should have occurred, you know, right around, as I said, the NASA facility in Houston. And, you know, we do get a lot of reports of things like Bigfoot and UFOs seen, you know, around military installations.
Yeah, and UFOs as well. Did you say UFOs?
Oh, yeah, a lot of UFO activity okay. around. Yeah, but there was a famous wave in 1975 in the northern part of the U.S., a lot of military bases, and particularly things like missile bases. You know, they reported a massive amount of UFO activity throughout late 75.
I found it interesting in here you kind of debunked the whole mermaid special that had been on, that was apparently an April Fool's joke, and that so many people took seriously. Personally, I had missed it. I didn't even know it was on. I just heard people talking about it afterwards. But I was glad to see you talk about that, and I also was glad to see you address the bloop, I guess, for lack of a better...
Well, bloop's an interesting one. It deals with this strange target, if you like, that was picked up in the South Atlantic back in the 1990s, essentially using the equivalent of like sonar, you know, the equivalent of radar to track an aircraft in the sky. And the tracking equipment was actually born out of Cold War technology to track for Soviet submarines. You know, the worst case scenario was that, you know, while the missiles were guarding the country, you know, and everybody was looking to make sure the Russians didn't launch a sneak attack, you know, a land-based attack, the other big fear was that they would sort of build up their submarine fleet and sort of creep along slowly towards the U.S. coastline until it was surrounded, you know, and then launch a sneak attack. So the military came up with this very important program to sort of monitor the oceans for, you know, the movements of Soviet submarines, which was a, you know, very good and worthwhile program, because it may well have helped prevent, you know, any sort of sneak attack occurring. But the same technology that was employed in the submarine tracking was later used by civilian arms of government involved in sort of underwater experiments and researching the oceans. And on one occasion, this particular technology picked up something vast moving under the ocean, I mean, gigantic. Nobody knew what it was, and there were theories of, you know, could it have been a broken bit of an iceberg or something? Nobody really knew, but a number of analysts who studied it said that the signature of it was very much like a real living creature. You know, it didn't seem to be inanimate, it seemed to be like a living creature of some sort. But whatever it was, you know, we're not talking about a 20 or 30 foot long, or even like a 50 foot long giant squid. I mean, we're talking about a couple of hundred feet long, you know, gigantic thing. So, I mean, but who can say, you know, the oceans are very, very deep. A lot of them aren't very well explored. And, you know, if you've got something, a colony of creatures that live predominantly or chiefly, you know, way down, thousands of feet, well, who knows what's down there? And so bloop's one of these things that, depending on who you speak to, somebody might say, well, we think it was an iceberg, and somebody else is, no, that was, well, we don't know what it was, but it was alive, you know.
Okay, I heard an explanation somewhat recently that it was a large chunk of ice breaking off Antarctica or something to that effect.
Yeah, that's what I said. Yeah, like an ice floe or a bit of an iceberg breaking off and, you know, sort of moving through the waters and under the water, and it gave it the impression that it was, you know, something living. But as I said, other people who had previously analyzed some of these unidentified targets said it did seem to have more of like an animate sense to it, rather than just something that was just, you know, wildly or moving, you know, at random or whatever.
Well, one of the things that kind of disturbed me that the government did that you had pulled up the files on was called Acoustic Kitty.
Yeah, that's probably the most surreal thing I uncovered.
It almost seems like it's something that someone came up with a really bad idea and no one else realized what a bad idea it was until it was too late. So if you want to explain it to people.
Yeah, sure. I mean, it's one of these situations where, you know, sort of programs and operations and projects at the height of the Cold War a lot of ideas get sort of, you know, bandied around, and some of them work and some of them don't, you know, and they just get sort of languish in obscurity because they got cancelled as just not being feasible. And that was the case with this one. But Acoustic Kitty was a CIA operation, and again, the CIA have now released some of their files through the Freedom of Information Act on this subject. And the plan was that the idea was to try and get closer to and understand what, you know, the Soviets were talking about and doing inside the Soviet embassy in Washington, D.C. You know, that was obviously, you know, the Soviet embassy, and, you know, the U.S. wanted to know what was going on in there, what was being said, etc. And, of course, you know, not being sort of allowed in there, their sort of ability to do that was very limited. So they came up with this very strange plan to insert, like, bugging devices into the transmitters into the bodies of cats, living cats, you know, and hopefully keep them alive, but insert all this sort of metal wiring and bugging devices implanted into their bodies. And the idea was to sort of release them as close as they could to the embassy and try and encourage them to sort of make their way through the gates and wander around the Soviet embassy. And, you know, all the time they would be transmitting about the conversations of anybody who was in close distance to the microphone, you know, that the cat would also have embedded in its skin. And, you know, it seems like one of these situations where everything would have to be in the right place at the right time, you know, for it to even work. But they went ahead and actually got a cat and implanted some, like, a transmitter in its tail and a microphone somewhere else. And incredibly, the cat actually survived the surgery, you know, became like Robo Cat or something like that. And so what happened was, when the cat was fully recovered from the surgery and, you know, the wounds and stitches were all figured out or whatever, they put him in the back of a van, and a bunch of agents went out and parked as close as they could to the embassy without acting, looking suspicious, opened the back doors of the van to let the cat out and try and encourage it to cross the road, and it got flattened by a taxi when it had got about 10 feet. And so that was the end of the program. They basically said, well, you know, in theory it could work, but in practice, there were so many, you know, issues and things that couldn't be predicted, that it was just seen as being too expensive and costly, and, you know, they just, it just worked great on paper, but in, you know, the real world's a very different place.
And you cover a few things in this book like that, both on our side and then from the USSR, where they tried different almost absurd sounding ideas to use animals or create monsters and such.
Yeah, I mean, this is that one you're talking about goes back to the 1920s with the Soviet Union, and a Russian scientist named Ilya Ivanov, who was kind of like a real life Dr. Frankenstein almost. He had this obsession with trying to crossbreed humans with apes. But what was incredible, and this is why I included it in the book, is because the Soviet government's Academy of Sciences actually funded him to a significant degree to travel to West Africa, where he went with a fully equipped team, and they would capture and anesthetize gorillas and chimpanzees and impregnate them with human male sperm to see if they could, you know, create or get the female gorilla or chimpanzee pregnant. Now, the official story is that all these experiments failed. And certainly, you know, nature has sort of inbuilt alarms, almost, if you like, to try and prevent sort of crossbreeding from occurring, because invariably, even if it happens, you very often find that the creature that's born is either sickly, doesn't live long, or, you know, it has all sorts of genetic problems and things like that.
Right.
But there are a few rumors that, against all the odds, supposedly one or two freakish offspring were born. You know, we just don't know. We don't have any proof of that. But we do, I mean, we do have fully have proof that the experiments went ahead. The Russian government have now released the files on the experiments. Or at least some of them. So we know they went ahead, we know they were funded in West Africa, and also a number of experiments were undertaken in Russia. Just recently, actually, a couple of years ago, Workman building, I forget what the city was now, but they were building this, like a children's playground, and as they dug down into the concrete, they actually stumbled upon one of these old underground labs and found a load of ape skeletons in there, and then they realized what it was when, you know, the authorities did checks. It was one of these old places where Ivanov had done his experiments. So, you know, a lot of weird stuff went on, you know, and I don't think we can ever fully rule it out, even though, you know, there's never been officially an example of a crossbred human and an ape. But there's actually quite a few stories and rumors out there, not just relating to the Russians, but, you know, other cases as well. So, you know, sometimes nature does, you know, pop up weird things, you know, that against all the odds shouldn't exist, but they do, you know.
True. And if anyone finds this interesting, I highly recommend they pick up your book, Monster Files. It has a great subtitle, too, by the way. A look inside government secrets and classified documents on bizarre creatures and extraordinary animals.
Hey, you need to take a deep breath to just say the subtitle.
but it's such a perfect subtitle because that's exactly what it is. And
you have to sort of be able to tell the reader, you know, what they're actually going to be reading.
Yeah. And I love kind of the Pulp Fiction sort of cover that you used for it.
Yeah, they did a good cover. They basically sort of contracted with a professional artist to do one. And, you know, it looked a good picture. You got this sort of old Pirates of the Caribbean type ship being attacked by this Godzilla-sized sea serpent. So I like that cover. It's a good one.
Now, I don't think... I might be wrong about this, but I don't remember you covering anything on the Chupacabra in this, did you?
Not in that one, I didn't, no. The main reason I didn't is because I've done that in various other books. I've been on a number of expeditions to Puerto Rico looking for the Chupacabra, and so again, rather than go over old ground, you know, I would have put something in, but even in the earlier books, you know, I actually talked about the government aspect of that anyway, and there was no real new material to add to it, so there was no point, really.
Right. I knew you had covered it, and I couldn't remember if it was in here or something else. What are your feelings on the Chupacabra at this point?
Well, you know, having been to Puerto Rico on a number of occasions, my personal view is that whatever it is, it's real, but I have no idea what it is. I mean, I've spoken to everybody like police officers, veterinarians, ranchers, members of the public, civil defense workers, you know, they've all got their own input. You know, I spoke to veterinarians who autopsied farm animals reportedly killed by the creatures where there were puncture wounds on the neck and significant amounts of blood removed from the bodies. I had a fascinating chat when I was there, I think it was when I went in 2005, and he was a former civil defense operative, and when he retired, the agency actually gave him all the Chupacabra files that he put together when he was working for them. He was actually like he would go out as part of his official job and investigate cases for Puerto Rico Civil Defense Department. And he actually showed this to him. It was like a 2-inch thick file of all these drawings that people had made of the creatures they'd seen and, you know, witness reports all typed out, etc. And, you know, when you sort of sit down opposite people like this and they tell you their stories, then it really takes it away from just being something you read in a magazine or on the internet. And you realize these are real people, highly credible people. And so there's no doubt in my mind that it's something. Now, every time I've been there, I've heard various theories time and time again. There's sort of a set number of theories. There's the idea that it's an extraterrestrial creature. You know, admittedly, there have been a lot of UFO sightings all around Puerto Rico for years. So you have the alien angle. Other people believe that it could be something like a giant bat because, admittedly, you know, it has sort of the typical attack mode of like a vampire bat. And some people have talked about it having kind of like a monkey-like face and body and bat-like wings, leathery wings, which kind of describes a bat. But, you know, they're talking about something much larger. Other people talk about sort of weird genetic experiments going on and in various labs, and maybe these creatures have escaped. And then you've got the supernatural theory that, you know, some sort of occult group has conjured it up from some, you know, supernatural realm or whatever. And those are the sort of main theories I've heard time and again when I've been there.
Which one do you, if you had to pick one that you would think would be more likely over another, what do you think it would be?
I think it's some sort of unknown animal. I think for me, it's possibly something that we haven't found yet. Now, people say, well, if that's the case, why did the reports only surface in the 90s or onwards? But if you look into it, that actually isn't the case. But because if you go back to the 80s, there's a part of Puerto Rico called Moca. And in the 80s, they were having attacks on farm animals, very similar to the ones, the more famous ones in the 90s onwards. And the attacker became known as the Moca vampire. And so, in other words, you know, this sounds like the Chupacabra. And in the 70s, there were reports of creatures known as devil birds, which, again, had these leathery wings that makes them sound like the Chupacabra that became more famous in the 90s. And if you go back in the 60s, Puerto Rico is home to the famous Arecibo telescope. Well, there's a famous story of a cow being found dead and mutilated and drained of blood right on the fringes of the telescope in the mid-60s. And what was weird is that people talked about seeing this sort of black-cloaked or winged creature hovering around the area at the same time. So in other words, what I think's happened is that this creature or creatures have been there possibly for as long as, you know, the island's been there. But through popular culture and et cetera, the term Chupacabra and the recognition given to it has only occurred since the 90s. It's since before that. You know, it went under the radar. Nobody was looking, you know. But I think it's when you look into it, you actually find the cases go further and further back. It's not just a recent phenomenon at all.
Hmm. Okay. You're on WVBR FM Ithaca. We are talking to Nick Redfern. And one of the things I wanted to get into real quick with you, you're one of the, as far as I know, one of the few people who's actually written extensively on the Men in Black.
Hmm. Yeah, I'm actually working on a third book on it now. Right?
Really?
Yeah, because I get so many reports. But again, that's sort of that's probably one of my favorite areas of research, because it's sort of a strange one. You know, everybody thinks of the Men in Black. They think of Tommy Lee Jones and Will Smith,
right.
You know. That's the movie image. A lot of people don't realize that the movie franchise was based on a comic book series, and the comic books were based on, or inspired, I should say, by real-life reports of Men in Black. But whereas, you know, in the movies, the MIB are, you know, they look like and act like government agents, which is what they are. They're from a secret agency. But when you read the vast majority, I'd say a good 90% of the reports where people have seen the Men in Black, they're sort of far stranger. They're typically described as only being like 5 feet to 5 feet, 5 tall. You know, their skin's pale to the point of looking anemic. They look sickly. They look anorexic. Their clothes kind of hang on them, and they wear these sort of old-style 50s suits and fedora hats, and they sometimes have these bulging eyes, which they hide behind wraparound sunglasses, and which has sort of given rise to the idea that, you know, there's something extraterrestrial themselves or something paranormal, and they're sort of camouflaging themselves to pass amongst us, you know, where if you just glance at them, you might not notice all these subtle things, you know, unless you look closer. So in other words, the real Men in Black are very different to the movie versions, and, you know, about as far removed as you can get from government agencies. And I think they are something, you know, paranormal, however we define what the paranormal is. And but we find the MIB pop up in all sorts of situations. For example, the book I'm working on now, there are cases where people got MIB visits after using Ouija boards, nothing to do with UFOs, you know, mm-hmm. But they still got the knock on the door and were warned, you know, not to dabble in the black arts, so to speak, you know. And there are other cases where, for example, there are some Loch Ness Monster cases where people, you know, witnessed an MIB after studying or looking into the Loch Ness Monster. So, in other words, these things seem to pop up and issue threats where, not just in relation to UFOs, but where people are looking into any sort of perceived paranormal mystery. And, you know, it's sort of, a lot of people think it is the government angle, but the more you look into it, that's sort of so far removed from the reality that it's, you know, it's much, much stranger.
Well, do you think there are some cases where the government has used that as a cover?
Yeah, I actually do. This is where it gets complicated, because you have these legitimately weird MIB. But I think sometimes what's happened is that government agencies, you know, clearly want to, if it's a sensitive case, they may want to go out and interview the witnesses to get the full story, etc. But I think sometimes they've sort of camouflaged themselves or portrayed themselves as the weirder MIB, and they've dressed in the black suits and the fedora hats, and, you know, to sort of perpetuate the image of the classic Men in Black, but also to cover their own tracks. And so, in other words, I think that does happen. We've had people in government who've basically, you know, sort of pretended to be the real MIB because it does act as a good camouflage. And of course, they realise that, well, if you tell people you were visited by the Men in Black, nobody's going to believe you at all. You know? And so I think it acts as a good cover, but it confuses the issue because, you know, we have the real MIB, the weirder ones. We have possibly government people pretending to be them to cover the tracks. And then, of course, back in the 50s, where there may have been just legitimate visits, well, that's how the guys all dressed back then, you know, black suits and fedoras.
Right.
That was the typical normal dress. So potentially you've got three different categories. And then, of course, there are all the different theories for what the MIB are. You know, you've got everything from aliens to some sort of occult-type creature. Some people even take, like, the demonic approach, you know, that they're literally demons in disguise. Then you've got the time traveler theory that it's us from the future, you know, and they're coming back to try and beef up their stock in the future, you know, by with abductions, you know, taking human eggs and DNA and whatever, and the MIB are here to try and keep it all under wraps so the people of the present don't know.
Right.
People of the future come back. So, you know, you've got all these different theories, and that, for me, is why I find it sort of so fascinating, because there are so many different aspects to it.
Well, I find it interesting that people who have, for instance, UFO encounters, then often have paranormal things following them around after that, which to me suggests that the UFOs also don't have, you know, must have some connection to this phenomena in some way, shape, or form.
Yeah, I mean, when people think of UFOs, you know, they initially or mostly think of aliens and extraterrestrials. For me, I think, certainly when I was a kid, you know, I sort of thought it was all black and white, you know, UFOs were aliens, Bigfoot was a giant ape, etc. But a lot of my views changed over the years, and that in relation to UFOs as well. I think it's more likely, instead of being nuts and bolts craft from, you know, this star system or that star system, I think they're more likely to be something sort of interdimensional, extra-dimensional, that sort of coexists with us. And that's more of like a paranormal nature, possibly, and that, you know, can manipulate our minds to where we see it as he wants us to see it, you know. Perhaps it can actually, you know, manifest in different ways according to even the beliefs of the viewer, you know. Yeah. Kind of almost like a Matrix-type world kind of thing. And, you know, I mean, for example, I've got MIB reports where the witnesses saw a UFO, which is more, you know, associated with aliens. They got the visit from the Men in Black, and then almost immediately afterwards, they started experiencing violent poltergeist activity in the home. Now, most people in the UFO field who take a purely nuts and bolts approach would probably not even touch a case that involved poltergeist activity within a UFO. You know, they'd write it off. But for me, if you write it off, that's sort of, you know, that's a disservice to the witness.
Yeah.
Because the witness is the most important person, as I said, you know, and people shouldn't be denying the evidence because it doesn't fit their belief system. So I think when you get these stranger aspects, or, you know, spin-off things, like I said, poltergeist activity and things like this, that we've got to take a fresh look at what the UFO phenomenon is. You know, is it extraterrestrial? Is it something that masquerades as extraterrestrial for reasons we don't understand, but that is covering its real origins, you know?
And it could be that it's partly what it is and partly what our perceptions need it to be in order to understand it at all.
Yeah, I think there's something to that because, you know, I mean, you can find people over the last few thousand years, you know, who have had experiences very similar to today's cases where, you know, somebody goes out into the desert in the 50s and sees, like, a benevolent, long-haired space brother. Well, there's not much difference to that than going out to the desert of the Middle East 2,000 years ago and Moses going up the mountain and get the Ten Commandments, yeah, which is basically telling us how to live, and then today somebody says, well, the aliens told me we've got to disarm our nukes. You know, all these stories are the same, where you have higher entities targeting certain people whose lives are sort of profoundly changed, and then they go on a mission to spread the word. You know, you can find that throughout religion, throughout the whole contactee movement of the UFO field and abductions, that kind of thing. And you know, it kind of parallels very closely as well, people, you know, being kidnapped by the so-called the little people in the 1500s, you know, in Ireland or whatever. So I think the phenomenon possibly has the ability to manipulate the human mind, and it appears in the form that is most acceptable to the people of that day, you know. When people perhaps saw angels or demons thousands of years ago, that's how they really appeared. People in the 1500s or 1600s, they may have appeared in the form of goblins when goblins were believed in. You know, in the 50s, it was the long-haired Space Brothers. Today, it's the Greys, yeah. You know. And so who knows what it'll be 100 years from now, maybe something else. But I think something is interacting with us, and it could be like a teaching process or a learning process. You know, who knows? It could be multiple things, but I think for some reason this phenomenon needs to interact with us. It almost like it's like a symbiotic relationship we have with it. And so, you know, I think there's more going on. A lot of sightings, I don't think they're random events. I think they're sort of almost like staged for the benefit of the witness for some particular reason.
Yeah, that's always the impression I've gotten as well, that it's almost like a performance.
Well, yeah, because back in the 50s, you know, a lot of people would be sort of driving down a road at random, and they'd come across aliens taking soil samples at the edge of the road. Yeah. There's countless cases like that, but it's like, how many people really are going to keep stumbling on aliens over and over again taking soil samples? You know, and to me, it comes off as like a staged event. It's meant to appear random, and I think it's being done at least partly to ensure that people see them. I think that's part of the reason for them coming here, or whatever they are, is a need to be seen. Now, possibly to sort of spread like a meme-like idea that we're being visited by aliens, if they're actually something else, you know, that would be an ingenious way is to make it look like they were accidentally being seen and instilling the idea of the viewer that, oh, well, they're extraterrestrials, when maybe they're something else, you know.
Yeah. When I talked to David Weatherly, I mean, the black-eyed children phenomena he investigated also, to me at least, rang very similar to the Men in Black. I mean, different on the main thing, but the archetype of it was very similar.
Yeah, it is, where you've got these sort of weird, creepy-looking... I mean, the black-eyed children, they look creepy. You know, they've got hoodies on and these white faces and no emotions and these black eyes, and they want to come in the house. It's just like the Men in Black, you know, they're pale, they look weird, they wear hats, you know, not a hoodie, but they wear a hat, and they want to come in the house. You know, and what's interesting is that the black-eyed children and the Men in Black, you know, they say they want to come in the house, they don't force their way in, and they ask, you know, which is kind of like the old vampire legends, where the vampire, for the first time, can't come in the house unless you let it in.
Yeah.
You know, so I sometimes wonder if some of these old vampire stories may have actually been born out of, you know, old encounters with the Men in Black, you know, that came to somebody's old doorstep in some village, you know, in the Middle Ages or whatever, and demanded to be let in. I mean, if you think about it, there's not much difference between a pale-faced man in black asking to be let in the house in, say, 1965, or in 1665, a black-cloaked, pale-faced vampire wanting to be let into a little cottage in, you know, some English village, you know.
Yeah.
There's not much difference, you know. It's just the term, you know, Men in Black versus vampire. But, and, of course, the other parallel with the Men in Black and sort of the whole vampire issue is that, you know, vampires live on human blood. You know, they suck the blood dry. They use us as a food source. Well, a lot of people who have had MIB experiences have felt that the MIB have sort of drained them of energy, kind of like the way a diabetic might feel, you know, if they missed a meal or two meals, you know, they start to crash. And that's how a lot of witnesses have felt. They felt suddenly tired and drained of energy, as if the MIB, their whole purpose is actually like a psychic vampire to sort of bleed us of psychic energy or something like that. So maybe there's a tie in there with the black-eyed children as well, you know, because some of them often say, you know, it's feeding time, we want feeding.
Yeah.
You know, so maybe that's another thing. Maybe they're not looking for literal food. Maybe we're like an energy source to them, you know. Again, kind of like in The Matrix, you know, where we're all in these, in reality, the real life is we're all in these sort of pods in these endless factories, and we're being used to create electricity for the machines, you know. Maybe it's a similar thing, who knows.
All right. Well, we're just about done for tonight. You're going to be at the Paradigm Symposium coming up.
Yep. In Minneapolis in, I think it's the third weekend in October.
Yeah. And are you going to be talking mostly about this book or other stuff?
No, actually, I'm going to be talking, I think it's going to be predominantly UFOs, sort of just new stuff I'm looking into and, you know, new data on old cases and whatever. So.
Okay. What's the next book you plan on putting out?
I'm not sure which will be out first, but actually, as I said, I'm working on this new Men in Black book, and I'm hoping to complete that very soon. So I think that will hopefully be out before the end of the year, sort of maybe November. But this is a bit different because whereas all my other books have sort of been written, you know, obviously by me, this one is where the witnesses, their accounts, the bulk of the book will be made up just of the witness accounts. And what I'm doing, I'm sort of doing an introductory paragraph to each account, and then there'll be like an analysis section after from me, but you know, really sort of like a paragraph for me to start with, and perhaps three or four paragraphs after, and then two or three pages will be, you know, the word for word account of the witness, and there'll be like sort of 40 or 50 case files, you know, that have never been seen before. So.
Oh, wow. Okay. Any estimate when that might be done?
Hopefully by sort of about November, I'm hoping for something.
That seems it would be about your six month break
exactly.
There.
Yeah.
All right. And you have a blog up on online people can follow you at. Where is that?
At Nick Redfern 14, fortean.blogspot.com. And I try and update that pretty much every day. And people contact me there via the Facebook link. And you know, always pleased and happy to chat with people if anybody's got any questions or want to share stories, or you know, if they want any answers to an experience they've had, you know, as I said, I'm always happy to chat. I'm not one of these sort of standoffish ego types, you know, oh, I'm an author, you know. No, we're all in this together, you know, we're all looking for answers. So, you know, I'm always happy to hang out and chat with people.
All right. And your book is, I guess all your books are probably available on Amazon and all the normal places.
Yeah, you get them at Amazon, Barnes & Noble, online, and any of the books published by New Page Books, which includes Monster Files, you can go into Barnes & Noble and get them off the shelves as well.
All right. Well, I thank you, Nick. It's been fascinating, and thank you for the immense amount of work that you put out, and it's fantastic.
Yeah, well, thanks, Ryan. Thanks for having me on the show.
All right. The Last Exit for the Lost is up next. We're going to be taking you out instead of the traditional Psyche Corporation. Something a little older, about 10 years old, from someone named Zakas out in Las Vegas. We're going to hear El Chupacabra. See you next week.